Psalm 34:1 says, "I will bless the Lord at all times, and His praise shall continually be in my mouth." Well, good evening and welcome back to our weekly prayer time. That's exactly what we want to do. We want to bless the name of the Lord, and we want to speak with our mouths and with our hearts a word of praise to Him. I am so glad that you are here. Thank you for allowing me a couple of weeks to kind of step away from this. We had the holidays, and then last week I was quarantined, but I'm all good. I had a test. So thank you for your praying for us and asking on us and checking about us. We are all good, as they say. But man, we have returned here tonight to pray. We have returned here tonight to worship. We have returned here tonight to encourage one another, all through the venue of praying. And so I am so glad that you are here tonight. And don't forget, you can drop your prayer request, whatever it may be, in the comment section below, whether you're watching it live or you're watching it later, and we will pray. Because here's what we believe about prayer. We believe prayer is us asking God to do what only He can do, but trusting that He can and that He will. The Bible says you do not have because you do not ask. And so we are asking God to do great and miraculous things in our neighborhoods and in our nations to bring about both revival, awakening, and His glorification on earth as it is in heaven. So thank you so much for joining us. And I'm excited about where this is going to go. We've been praying a lot as a staff and talking about future plans for what this kind of weekly prayer gathering looks like, particularly as we think about hopefully one day, God willing, and it will, the pandemic ending, us be able to just gather together and just pour out together. So just be on the lookout for that and just be praying about that too, what God would have you, or if God would have you be a part of that. So, but I'll tell you more about that as we can. But tonight we're here to pray. So let me do this. Before we pray, before we kind of get into our corporate praying or our together praying, let me just pray and open us up and ask God to help us, I mean, focus for these next few moments on the heavy lifting of the faith in prayer. So Father God, in Jesus' name we pray. We ask God that You would do far more abundantly than we can imagine through our praying, God, that through our praying, You would be glorified, Your name would be magnified, and things would happen on earth as they do in heaven, God. And so, Father, we know tonight that our praying is not just talking out loud, and it's not just spiritual ritualism, Father, but what we are doing is worship, and what we are doing is communion. So, Father, commune with us right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we followed this format before, and it's kind of what I want us to do tonight is we just kind of set our eyes on the new year. As we set our eyes on what God would have us to do and what God has already begun to do in our church, in our neighborhoods, and in the nation. So tonight we're just going to walk through our simple formula of acts. That's where we're going to pray about adoration. That means we're going to worship God in prayer. You know, we often think about worship as just being a time when we're all together and music's going or preaching, and that's certainly a type of worship, but then we also worship through prayer, because when we are praying, we are submitting ourselves not to our own power, but to the authority of God, and we are acknowledging God as all-powerful. That's worship. So first, we're going to worship God through adoration. Number two, we're going to practice confession. So I'm excited about that. Confession is important. Nay, it is imperative for believers to make sure that our sins are confessed so that there is nothing kind of standing in the way between us and God, between what God wants us to do for Him and something that's kind of gnawing at us or getting in the way. So confession's important. Confession's beautiful. Confession's hard work, but it's ultimately redemptive. Then we want to spend some time thanking God. You know, I think 2020 was definitely a tough year, no doubt. 2021 is off to a rocky start, but there are still things to be thankful for. Yeah, we can say we're thankful for our health or for our jobs, and that's good, and that's solid. But man, we're also thankful that God doesn't abandon us, right? Aren't you thankful that even though the waves climb and the seas rage, that God is still there? Aren't you thankful that every time you and I mess up, God doesn't just say, well, I'm going to take their salvation from them? Aren't you thankful that every time we need to talk to God, He's right there? So there's a lot to be thankful for. And then finally, we're just going to spend some time in supplication or just asking God to do what only He can do. Here's what you and I can do. On our own, we can do a little bit. God can do all of it. God can bring the return tenfold. God can save and He does save. God can heal and He does heal. But you and I can't do any of those things, but we need God to do that. We need God to do things, and we pray that He would use us as the church to do it. So I'm excited. This is one of my favorite formulas, if you will, to pray. And really, not a formula is probably not a really good way to say that, but really just more of a way of kind of categorizing and thinking about praying so that I'm the most on point as that I can be. So let's just jump right into it tonight with adoration. If you have a Bible, or you can look on the screen, I'm going to look at Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, here's what we want to see. We want to see, why is Jesus worthy to be praised? I mean, that's a fair question, right? We just assume, well, He's Jesus, you have to worship Him, and yes. But what does the Bible say about some kind of particular reasons that we should worship Jesus and just give all praise to Jesus? Well, look at Colossians 1, starting in verse 15. Here's what it says. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation. For by Him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through Him and for Him. And He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. And He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything He might be preeminent. For in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Him to reconcile Himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of His cross. Did you catch what Paul's saying there in that first section? He is saying that without Jesus, nothing has happened and nothing will happen. He's saying even creation, even before creation, eternity's past, everything happened in and through Jesus. When God was creating the earth, Jesus was there creating the earth with God. When it says that He died the first day, He died so that you and I could live. And how did He do it? By the cross. So in Jesus and through Jesus, everything happens, has happened, and will happen. And that's just an incredible thought to think that Jesus has reconciled us to God by His blood. I don't know about you, but that's something that we could just shout about. That's something that we could just start just yelling, praise God about, because Jesus did this. And He had to, because you and I couldn't do it. And so that's what we want to start with. We just want to praise the name of Jesus in our praying. Spend a few moments. There's some questions and guidelines really on the screen if you want to, but just spend some time in worship, praying and thanking God for Jesus, telling Jesus how good He is and what He has done and how magnificent He is. You know, Philippians says that it is the name above all names. So do this. Pray for just a moment with a smile on your face about how good God is through Jesus. So take a few moments and pray right now. So God, because of the work of Jesus, we are saved. Because of the work of Jesus, we are kept. Because of the work of Jesus, we have something to celebrate. So Father, thank you so much. Praise the name of Jesus. God, would I never tire of doing that, Father, praising Jesus, praising Him for my salvation, praising Him that He paid the sacrifice so that I could live. In His name we pray. Amen. And isn't it incredible sometimes just to pray about the glory of Jesus? What an incredible idea that, man, I can just in my couch, in my car, wherever I am, I can just spend a few moments worshiping by praising the name of Jesus. Amen. If you have a prayer request, drop it in the comment section below. Whether you're watching it live or you're watching it later, we want to pray for you. This is a conversation. It's just not me talking and you listening. It's us praying. It's us dialoguing with each other, and we're talking to God. And so, and we want to make sure that we aren't just noisy cymbals here and gongs, that we're actually talking to the Father and talking with each other. So drop those there if you have it. Well, let's move on. We've talked about adoration, that is praising the name of Jesus. Well, let's talk about confession. Flip to your Bible to 1 John chapter 1. You know, we often think about confession as I store up all of these bad things I've done, and then I have this kind of like cathartic moment where all of a sudden I'm like, oh, I need to ask for forgiveness of all these because the guilt and shame is so heavy that I don't know what else to do. And there are certainly those times, don't get me wrong, but confession is a beautiful, beautiful thing in Scripture. Confession is meant for us to kind of have this ongoing dialogue and conversation with the Lord. It's not meant for us to just say, okay, let me save up some things till I really have something to confess. No, confession is a beautiful, beautiful picture of the ongoing effects and work of the blood of Jesus. Every time I sin, I'm saying, God, would you forgive me for this right now so that there's nothing that stands between you and me? Because here's what happens. When you and I have unrepentant sin, it begins to cloud our hearing. And I'm kind of using that metaphorically, but it really does. It begins to cloud our hearing between us and God. Now, God is more powerful than sin, so don't hear me say He's not, but we aren't. You and I aren't more powerful than sin other than through the Holy Spirit. So what happens, though, is when we have these unrepentant sins, man, it just kind of piles up and it beats us down and it puts shame and it puts guilt on us. And all of a sudden, all we can think about are those things. And it's just put this divide that doesn't need to be there, temporary as it may be. It doesn't need to be there, and it doesn't have to be. You know, I really think shame and guilt are one of the best ploys of the devil. If he can get you as a believer to not confess your sins and to just harp on them and to think about how terrible and how horrible of a person you are and how there's no way God can forgive you, then what he's done is he has taken you off the field of battle. He has put you in your recliner and said, I'm not good enough, therefore I just won't serve the King. The complete opposite of what Scripture says. Scripture says that God saved you once and for all, but He also forgives you. He doesn't want you to live a life of shame. He doesn't want you to live a life of guilt. God doesn't want anybody who submits to Him as King to be on the sidelines. He wants us to be prayed up, repented up, and ready. Look at 1 John chapter 1. Let me just show you the beautiful picture of confession. 1 John chapter 1, verse 8 and verse 9. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. So first thing we have to do is we have to acknowledge that we have sin. But look what it says. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So do you see the promise there? Number one, we have to acknowledge we have sin. I am not perfect. I sin. And I don't want to cast judgments, but neither are you, right? I mean, you wouldn't sit there and say, well, I'm perfect, I have no sin. Well, no, that's one thing you and I can agree on. We're both people who have sin. And so what we have to do, though, is we have to confess that sin. Why? Because God's keeping account so He knows how to punish us? No, so He can forgive us. That's a beautiful picture. That's a beautiful picture. It's not like the parent that says, you better tell me what you did right now or else. No. God is saying, look, I love you. I already saved you. I already demonstrated that through my Son. I just want you to confess it to me so I can forgive you. Right? Where your parent says, tell me what you did so I can punish you. God says, tell me what you did so I can forgive you. That's a beautiful picture. That is a beautiful picture of the gospel. That is a beautiful picture of a Father's love. So, Don't go into confession with your head down kicking rocks. Go into confession with your head held up high to Jesus, saying, Jesus, you secured my faith and you secure my forgiveness. God, forgive me for this and put me into service. So take a few moments right now and let's pray and let's just confess whatever's going on in our hearts. So God, thank you that you are faithful to forgive us. God, thank you that you do not keep score. God, thank you that you don't hold it over our heads and you're not looking to exact punishment, Father, because you put the punishment on Jesus. So God, would you help us, God, dare I say, rejoice in the beauty of confession, God, but at least lean into it knowing, God, that you want to make all things right. We trust you with this, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, amen, amen, and amen. That just needs to be a daily routine of our lives. Confession before God brings wholeness before God. So I hope that that's just something that you will make part of your practice. As we move on, don't forget if you have a prayer request, drop it down below. We want to pray. That's what we're here for. We're praying. So drop your prayer request down below. You don't give as much detail or as little detail as you want, just so that we can pray for you. Well, let's continue on. So we've worshiped Jesus with our praying, we have confessed our sins, and now we're just going to give thanksgiving. You know, I think one of the things that you hear over and over about whatever the current generation is, and I say that kind of current generation because you kind of hear this about every generation, is kind of a lack of thankfulness. You know, everybody's just kind of looking a gift horse in the mouth or whatever, and that may be true to some extent. I certainly don't want to get into that here, but sometimes that's what happens in our faith. Sometimes we just assume God is supposed to, or if he does, he was obligated to do that. Well, God, number one, isn't obligated to do anything, but number two, that which he does out of his own grace and out of his own mercy. And so what we do is we turn around and in an act of worship and really in an act of humility, we thank God. Some of us haven't had any job interruptions. We thank God for that. But some of us have had job interruptions. You think, well, where do I thank God in this midst? Man, I still thank God that he is still providing for me. Some of us have been sick. Some of you have been sick. Some of you have been healed. Some of you are waiting to be healed. But you still, we thank God that even in those times of waiting, he's present. So it's not always just about the outcome, although it is sometimes. Thankfulness is more about an attitude about humility for in ourselves, but thankfulness that God is present. that God is not abandoning us. It's thankful for all that God has done, all that God is doing, and all that God will do. So we create this attitude of thankfulness to God, of sheer, unadulterated appreciation for who God is and what God does. We just simply thank God. Do you have things in your life to be thankful for to God? Do you have things in your life, man, that you just need to spend a few moments right now and telling God, thanks be to you for blank? Or maybe it's just about God's character. Maybe you just need to thank God for His mercy or His grace or His love or His patience. Listen to Psalm 100, verse 4 and 5. Enter in His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. And look what it says in verse 5. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. Verse 5 right there is a really good template about what we can thank God for. Number one, we thank God that He is good. And by the way, God isn't good sometimes and not good other times. God is consistently good. So we thank Him for His consistency in being good. We thank Him for His steadfast love. God never stops loving you. Did you know that? There are people who will come and go from your lives. There are people who you love who you won't love at some point, or they won't love you because of personal disagreements or whatever. Doesn't happen with God. God's love endures forever. And look at what it says finally, and His faithfulness to all generations. How long is God faithful? Forever. How long has God been faithful? Forever. Surely that's something to be thankful for. You know, we're just starting the new year, and a lot of people have done New Year's resolutions, and most people are faithful to their New Year's resolutions for a whopping 3 days. 3 days. Their goal to lose weight, get in shape, whatever it may be. How long is God faithful? Forever. Surely you and I, even amidst where we are, can think of something to thank God for. There's some thoughts on the screen for you, some questions, some ideas to ponder. Just take a few moments right now and just spend some time thanking God. God, I'm thankful that Your love endures forever. God, I'm thankful that You don't give up on us. God, I'm thankful that even in my times where I am at my worst, God, I'm thankful that you are still faithful. And so, God, help me desire and develop an attitude of thankfulness for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, amen. So we've worshiped Jesus in his name through adoration. We have confessed our sin. We have given thanks to God for all that he is and all that he does and all that he will do. And so now it's time that we ask God. Now it's time that we lay our burdens, that we lay our needs and our desires at his feet. But do you notice the order of how we're praying? We're doing it like this. We're spending 3/4 of our time on God and 1/4 of the time on ourselves. Why do we do that? Why can't we just pray more about ourselves? And there's definitely nothing wrong with praying for yourself. Listen to me. You should pray for yourself. You should pray for others. But also, prayer just isn't that alone. Prayer is absolutely a worshipful experience. And if we're worshiping in prayer, then we have to have an object of our worship, and that's God. So, yes, we want to pray for ourselves. We want to ask God, and we'll see in Scripture where that's necessary. But we also want to spend time in prayer just getting to know God better, learning his attributes, understanding him, and confessing to him to remove all those things that hinder that. So I just kind of wanted to point that out. We do pray for ourselves and we do pray for others, but prayer is also more than just that. It is also a time for us to commune and communicate with God. So let's talk about supplication, the last point we're looking at tonight, supplication, or in other words, asking things from God. Look at James chapter 1, the book of James, chapter 1, verses 5 and 8. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable all his ways. So right here, James is talking about being steadfast in one's faith. Obviously, right here, he's talking about wisdom, and that's absolutely what he's talking about. But it's a really good outline for what it looks like for other things from us, because we need God for everything. We do. We need God for our breath. We need God for our health. We need God for our finances. We need God for our marriages. We need God for our country. We need God for the world. And so, yes, we need to ask wisdom, but this is a really good template to see who do we ask and who gives it. It's God. We ask God, God gives. But what's our attitude? Complete faith. When we pray with complete faith. Well, what does that mean, we pray in complete faith? Is that like, okay, I'm going to pray and I really believe God is going to do that? Yeah, partly, I think. But it's also when we pray knowing that God's the only one that can do it. It's almost this abandonment idea of ourselves saying, I'm going to pray about this because I know two things. Number one, I can't do it. But number two, I know that God is the only one that can. Listen to me. It's like this. Parenting. Whether you're parenting your kids or you're helping parent your grandkids, or whether it's a marriage or whatever it may be, you cannot fix it. I cannot fix it. I can do things that God tells me to do. I can love, I can cherish, I can have grace. I can do all that. But guess what? It takes two to tango. So ultimately, if God is going to have my marriage fixed, he's going to be the one to do it. If I need my kids, you know, quote unquote, fixed, God has to do it, but I have to ask in faith, knowing that I'm going to let God have control of this. I'm going to let God do what only he can do, but I have to ask in faith, knowing that he can do it. It's that simple. It's knowing that if God does, and this is a phrase I use thousands of times, so you're probably tired of hearing me say it, but it's just something I've developed and I know to be true. If God doesn't, it won't. Why? Because he is the author and the perfecter of our faith. In him and through him, all things were created. God is the one with the supernatural power, and I am not. So, yes, we ask God things. We ask God to do what only he can do. Because guess what? There's only one person who can do supernatural things. Guess what? It's God. So let's take a few moments right now and let's just ask God, whatever's on your heart, whatever's on your mind, maybe it's for a child, maybe it's for a marriage, maybe it's for a work, maybe it's for the salvation of one of your kids or your neighbor, maybe it's for the church, which it should be. I mean, churches right now in America need prayer to rise up and be the prophetic voice to speak the gospel into darkness. So there's a lot of things you can ask God for. Whatever that may be, whatever He lays on your heart, pray it now, but pray it in faith and trusting that only God can do it. So take a few moments right now and pray. So God, I am grateful that You don't always give me what I want, but God, that You always give me what I need for Your glory. So God, help me pray in line with Your will. God, help me to pray according to Your will. Help me pray so that the outcome is Your glory. And I'll give You the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I hope this has been a time for you tonight to just kind of refocus on praying. And let me encourage you again to if you don't have a regular prayer rhythm, this is a great rhythm that I've used for a long time. It's just the acronym ACTS, A-C-T-S, Adoration, Confession, Thanksgiving, Supplication. It's just a really easy way to think through and kind of categorize your praying. It does a couple of things. Number one, it helps you stay on task. And number two, it helps you be kind of pointed with how you are praying. So I hope this has been a blessing to you. I'm really excited about where we're going. We are talking and just praying about what prayer time will look like in the future. But here's one thing we know about this moment. This moment is not going away because it cannot go away. Prayer is the heavy lifting of the church. And all we can do is more of it and just trust God that He is doing His part. So just pray about that, and we will share more with you about that, but I'm excited about what that looks like. Let me just encourage you. I know that COVID is still rearing its ugly head, so if you do come to campus this weekend at our 8:30 or 10:45 service, please wear your mask. Make sure you're not sick. But if you're not comfortable, I completely understand that. You can watch us online at 8:30 and 10:45 and be a part of that. And also, you can call the church office or email us. If there's anything we can do or pray with you about, we are here to serve God above all, but we're also here to serve you. So if you need us, please let us know. Well, thank you so much for joining us tonight, and God bless you.